Mr. President, in rising to speak to the Energy Legislation Amendment, Licence Conditions Bill 2020, I can't help but making the observation that of all the stuff-ups that this government has been involved in over the past 6 years, energy is probably its greatest. Because without energy, society doesn't work. Business doesn't work. Families don't have the use of energy for their purposes. A whole range of people in our society just suffer as a result. It's hard to believe that just 6 years ago that Victoria had the cheapest and most reliable electricity in Australia. How things have changed. Now, electricity bills are through the roof, through the roof. My electricity bill last quarter was approaching $2,000. And that was, to my way of thinking, just outrageous. And I mean, we were only using what we needed to keep warm, basically. But that, you know, that is the norm these days. If you stay warm during winter, my God, you're going to pay come spring, because that is the way that this government has set things up, and that is a great tragedy. Because as I said, you know, we did have the cheapest, we did have the most reliable. Now, come summer, we know we're going to have blackouts. We know that when it gets to 35 or 36 degrees, sometimes even less, we know that large chunks of our power grid is going to fail. We know that that thousands and thousands of people, if not hundreds of thousands of people, will be stuck in the dark in the heat because the power system has failed. We know that gas is not really an option because this government does not want to explore, does not want to find gas. And it's interesting to listen to the president-elect, maybe, when he said a number of times during the campaign that he would never stop fracking. Now, over here, of course, that would be sacrilege. That would be something that you'd be put up against the wall and shot for in the ALP. But over there, Mr. Biden said there's no way that he was going to stop fracking. So you know, perhaps the left in Australia and the left in America might like to have a chat at some stage and see if they can get their act together. I don't know whether fracking is the answer or not, I have to say. I don't think it's probably all that necessary here at the moment. But we most certainly do need the research. We do need the exploration necessary to find conventional gas. And why on God's earth we're not doing that, I have no idea. I have no idea. That is just another part of the rat bag ideology of this extreme left-wing government, and that is a great pity to me, and a great pity to the people of Victoria, and particularly to families in Victoria. As I said before, my power bill was through the roof, and you know, when you're living on a budget, when you're struggling to get by and you're paying your mortgage or you're paying your rent, you've got to pay your food bill, you've got to pay a whole range of bills, you've got kids going to school, and that's not cheap. Even in the so-called free system, it's not cheap. So when you get a power bill for, you know, $1,000, $1,500, $2,000, that is a giant whack for any family. And that is something that that affects families in a very real way in this state. And I think it's very sad that the Premier and the government do not recognise that, that they do not accept that the suffering that families go through as a result of these extraordinarily high prices, it's a great tragedy that the government doesn't accept that this really hurts. This really hurts families. And of course it's not just families. And I've been hearing for some time now, the last few years, of elderly folk who don't get out of bed in the morning. They stay in bed all day. Or perhaps if they have to go out in the morning to get their shopping, they'll come home and go straight to bed because it is the only way they can keep warm because they can't afford electricity. They can't afford heating. They can't afford electric heating. They can't afford gas heating. What sort of society are we living in? What sort of a government do we have in this state that allows that to happen? That allows elderly people who have perhaps worked all their lives, paid taxes all their lives, raised their families, done all the right things all their lives, and this government treats them in this way when they get old? That is just appalling. And I've got to say to the House that that is not an irregular event. That is something that happens all too often where elderly people just cannot afford to get out of bed in winter. And that's a tragedy. And what they must go through in summer when it gets up to 35, 40 degrees, you fear to think. And I'm sure there are some who don't actually make it through there because that heat would actually kill them. And you just have to go down to the local shopping centre or the local cinemas perhaps or somewhere that is air conditioned to see aged people gathered in numbers to escape the heat because they cannot afford to have any cooling in their own home. As I say, what sort of a state are we living in? What sort of a government do we have that allows that sort of thing to happen? Then, of course, you have those, the unemployed, or perhaps those who are infirm, those who are disabled, they are struggling. They are struggling very much so. They are, I suppose, the traditional battlers. And they're the ones that I'm thinking of today because they're the ones who find it almost impossible to pay all these extraordinary bills. You know, the Labor Party like to talk about the need to look after the disadvantaged in the community, then they slug them with a power bill the size of which a horse couldn't swallow. It's just quite extraordinary in its own way that the Labor Party thinks in the way that it does. So if the Labor Party was fair dinkum, it would put ideology to one side and it would look after those people who are battling to pay their bills, those people who are living in fear of the postman coming and getting one of those bills that I spoke of just a moment ago. Then, of course, we have the impact that it has on small business, the impact these extraordinarily high power prices, energy prices have on small business. Now, it's been said quite often this year that small business has really suffered. Everybody has felt the impacts of the Wuhan virus, there's no doubt about that, but the small business community have particularly felt it, because it's really hit them. I was a small businessman, a very small businessman, some years ago before I came into this house, and I know what it's like to wait for the next cheque to arrive, to wait for the next payment, and pray that it mightn't be too far away. These small business people, you know, they are the heroes the national heroes, in fact, of our economy. Without them, we would not have an economy. It's as simple as that. Small business employs more than anybody else. And small business should get a better go from government than it does. And to have it being hit with these abominable power prices is just something that that should not be tolerated, because every time a small business operator goes broke, every time a small business operator closes his or her doors, jobs are lost. Jobs are lost. I'll put this in ways that members opposite might understand. If you don't have employers, you don't have employees. And if you don't have employees, you don't have union members. That might be the only thing that will impact members opposite if I appeal to their, their base self-interest. That's what it's about. The preservation of jobs, the preservation of these small business people, flowing through, of course, to the union movement. So it's just horrendous. And I go around and I speak to small business people all the time. And unfortunately, I haven't been able to get out as much this year as I had been last year. And last year, I travelled a fair portion of Victoria and spoke to small business operators one-on-one about the problems that they were facing. And I think just about every single one of them said to me the cost of energy, the cost of power was something that was knocking them around chronically. But this government doesn't care about that. This government doesn't care. And that in itself shows when these people in small business are impacted. And it's just dreadful. And we have the situation now where the small business, or many small business operators and many business operators generally, are preparing to flee Victoria. They're preparing to head interstate or indeed offshore. They've had enough. They've had enough. And they can see what's coming in Victoria. They can see what's coming in Victoria. And after today, I think we can all see what's coming in Victoria. And it won't be pleasant. And I suppose it's very sad to see business, to see jobs fleeing Victoria. But, in their situation, you can only blame them. With a government that is irresponsible, that is out of control as the Andrews government, it's little wonder that business wants to head north, south, east, west, anywhere, as long as they get away from the Victorian government. It should be remembered that one of the biggest impacts, reasons for the price rises, the savage price rises of which I speak, was the closure of the Hazelwood power station. Now this was a classic case of politics. A classic case of politics by the Andrews government. And I see Mrs. Taylor over there waving her arms in the air, and I suspect we've got another classic performance coming here. This could be particularly good. So I'm looking forward to that. It might even keep me awake. And that'll be a very good thing. So that'll be good. But the fact is that the Labor government, the Andrews government, was elected on the promise of closing down Hazelwood. And that's what they did. That's what they did. They went out of their way to deliberately close the Hazelwood power station and remove a quarter of our power capacity. Now, if you remove a quarter of our power capacity, of course prices are going to go through the roof. Of course we are going to have blackouts. Of course that's going to happen. Of course that's going to happen. But ideology, with this government, ideology comes before all else. I don't care about families. I don't care about old people. I don't care about the poor. I don't care about small business. I don't care about jobs. They just care about pushing their ideological barrow. And I don't care what impact that has on people, ordinary folk here in Victoria, whoever, wherever they may be. All impacted, all hit hard by policies from a government that is so wrapped up in its own ideological agenda, try saying that three times, ideological agenda, very hard to understand how they can do that to people who in many cases voted for them. And I talk about the western suburbs. You should see the impact these policies have in the western suburbs. But yet the people in the western suburbs largely put them there. Hard to understand, as I say, very hard to understand. But that is the reality of life in Victoria in 2020, where ideology, hard left ideology, is more important than the people of Victoria. I look forward to having a government soon where we will put people before politics.
Ms. Taylor.